Okay, so once more, my name is Grzegorz Kiarszys and I represent Department of Archaeology, Szczecin University, Poland. Cold War is usually defined by historians as a period between 1947 and 1991. 1947 is the moment when so-called Truman Doctrine was announced and United States, but also some states from Western Europe started to openly support countries threatened by the expansion of communism or Soviet Union. And 1991 is the year when Soviet Union collapsed. During those 44 years, political and military actions influenced life of almost every human being all around the globe and left many material relics. Those relics can be studied today through archaeological methods. And of course, Cold War was a conflict that certainly went beyond the borders. Here you got a map of Europe from the period I'm going briefly to refer to, from the late 1960s to the late 1980s. So as you can see, Europe at that time was divided between two hostile factions, Warsaw Pact and NATO. Of course, there were some changes in the alliances, for example, Spain, where we are now joined NATO in 1982. But before I say anything more, first we should ask the most crucial question. Can archaeological perspective bring any new quality to the studies of the Cold War? I'll be looking for answer to that question during my today's presentation. And as always, in such situations, I'm here, but often ask another question. Which domain is more suitable for studies of recent past events and modern conflict? Is it history or is it archaeology? For me, this division is completely artificial, as I believe that knowledge of historical sources and archival documents is critical for understanding of historical and archaeological record. And therefore, we need to be both archaeologists and historians at the same time. And that's the case study I'm going to refer to. Three former Soviet secret nuclear warhead storage facilities. We got some documents in the Institute of National Remembrance of Poland, which are called files of the Wisla Project, which refer directly to those three storage sites. But there's a large set of documents, but they cannot be considered as complete set. And later on, I will try to explain you why I believe so. And we are in this very unique political and historical situation that we can learn what the other side of the conflict knew about those places. We can learn what CIA and NATO knew about those storage facilities. Based on Freedom of Information Act, some of the reports, top secret reports, were declassified. They are still sometimes censored. However, the lecture is fascinating. However, they also sometimes repeat some myths that are waiting to be debunked. And they look very interesting if we confront them, actually, with places we can find in the forest. So why those facilities were built? Answer for that question we can find in the historical sources. On 26th of February 1965, top secret military training took place at the military training ground close to the Drawsko Pomorskie town. It's located in northwestern part of Poland. Part of this training was designed to examine how long will it take to transport tactical nuclear warheads from western part of Soviet Union to western part of Poland. Then R-11M ballistic missile systems, which are better known in the west of the codename SCAT-A, and use them against NATO. And the conclusion was that it would take too long, would be too dangerous. And therefore the decision was made that those warheads have to be brought closer to the future war zone, which would be located in East Germany. Warsaw Pact considered that it should answer on time to the threat during the future war in Europe with all its nuclear potential, and therefore if it would be unable to do so, most possibly the future war against NATO would be lost, and therefore those three facilities were built. On 25th of February 1967, the agreement between Polish People's Republic and Soviet Union was signed, and it was decided that three facilities will be built. And at the beginning, only 12 highest ranking Polish officers were informed about the purpose of this project. Poland was obliged, due to this agreement, to build those facilities and cover all costs. Those facilities were to be built based on plans supplied by Soviet Union. And then Polish government decided that those facilities will be handed over to Soviet Union, and it will have no influence, no control over those nuclear warheads that will be stored there. In case of war, some of those warheads were to be shared with Polish rocket units and air forces, but until then they were under control of Russian troops. There was quite interesting instruction which was issued regarding the camouflaging of the site during the construction, and there was also some instruction issued regarding disinformation. So every Polish army unit that was building the site was misinformed that in fact they are building bases for Russian communication units, and those bases will be used in a case of war. Also, every single unit had access only to a small part of the complex, never to the whole area. So single soldier could not really realize what he's building. Eventually, on 12 of December 1969, those bases were finished and handed over to Russian troops. And from the perspective of historical archives, we may say that this is the end of the history. Why? Because after that time, very few new documents were added to the Wisła files. New instruction was issued, which was saying that some vital documents have to be destroyed. Maps and plans have to be sent over to back to Moscow. So we will not find any maps or plans in the Wisła files, and therefore we will never learn from that set of documents how those bases were specially organized. And if you wish to use some archival aerial photographs from the era, like this vertical photography from 1975, we'll quickly learn that they were all censored. And obviously, those bases were not placed at the topographical maps either. So the archaeological perspective may help us to fill in this 22 years gap, and I will try to present you how we try to do this. So using some remote techniques, airborne laser scanning, aerial photography, declassified satellite imagery, we may try to recreate special plan of those bases, especially that two of them, there are three bases, two of them were badly damaged, almost all buildings were destroyed, and only one is preserved in a good state of preservation. So that's one of the plans from Brzeźnica Kolonia. This is Podborsk, and this is the base which is actually quite well preserved because there is state detention center there. So it was protected for all the time. There is also right now museum there, and those sites can be visited. And like I said, this is another base in Templewo. It was badly destroyed, and that's the reconstruction of that base. So I will try briefly to explain how the nuclear base was organized due to the data I collected, and I will do this based on the example of facility from Podborska, which, as I said, was the best preserved. So the base consisted of several zones. There was overbuilt zone, and it consisted of houses that were built for NCOs. Those houses were quite low standard buildings. Just beside them, there was area for officers with their quarters. And within this area, there was also a large gathering hall, there was laundry, and there was bathhouse with swimming pool. And beside that area, there was a barrack area where soldiers had their compulsory training, because there were also soldiers of compulsory training, and it consisted of warehouse, there was a large boiler house, there was headquarters and dining room and cinema for 120 persons, there was hospital, and there was also infantry barracks. In the case of war, the unit that was stationed within the base was expected to deliver tactical nuclear warheads to the places of dislocation of rocket units and air forces, and therefore large number of cars and trucks had to be kept within the base, and therefore the garage area was that large. And just beside the overbuilt zone, there was a restricted zone with a limited access that was used for storage purposes only. And in every three bases, the restricted zone consisted of two buildings, monolith type. Those were two-story concrete warehouses specially designed for keeping tactical nuclear warheads that were to be used in a future war in Europe. And that's one of the main rooms with efficient cooling system based on helium. And that's one of the rooms of four rooms in every each of such buildings that was used for storage of tactical nuclear warheads. Unfortunately, at two other bases, those sites were badly damaged and the equipment was removed from there. Also, the restricted zone consisted of a building which was a granite type building. It was built at the end of 1970s due to the advances of technology. Nuclear warheads did not have to be stored anymore in the restrictly controlled conditions, and it was built of prefabricates that were transported there. Unfortunately, at two other bases, those buildings were damaged here in, at Breznica Colonia. The gates were removed, but thanks to that, we can see how it is built, and we can see prefabricates. There was a crane hung at the ceiling as well, used for transportation and unloading the warheads. And of course, the restricted zone was surrounded by sophisticated system of trenches, different trenches. One of type of trenches, which is called type Sosna, was used especially for the signalization. It was connected to the signalization system. So if it was breached, then the quiet alarm was triggered and soldiers knew exactly the place where this fence was breached. And every base outside the restricted zone had its own shooting range, and those are relics of shooting range. At some stage, someone decided that this is unsafe to keep all the cars within the parking area for all the time. So car shelters were built and new roads leading to those shelters. And this is how the shelter looks like when it was used. And those are relics of such shelters, contemporary photography, at contemporary photography. Every road within the base was built of concrete plates like that. They have two advantages. First one is that they can withstand heavy vehicle movement. The other one is that they are grazed, perforated, and believe me, it is very difficult to identify them at the aerial photographs. So it is very difficult to say that actually we're dealing with concrete roads, not ordinary dirt roads. And whole base was surrounded by a system of shooting trenches and bunkers for protection. So probably you ask yourself now, did the enemy know? Did NATO or CIA learn about the purpose of those facilities? But before I will answer that question first, let's have a look at the imagery that was declassified, imagery from Corona mission that was collected on July 1969. So that's basically Podborsko and its image at Corona mission imagery. That's Brzeźnica Colonia, and again, with higher quality image of Brzeźnica Colonia. And that's Templewo and its image. So we have to remember that only because something was properly photographed at the high quality image, it does not necessarily mean that CIA or NATO interpreters knew what it was and could identify it, because it looks like they did not have a clue. Several months after the mission was finished, at the end of 1969, there are still reports which say we cannot tell for sure whether there are any nuclear weapons at all are stored in Eastern Europe. And for in the following years, the same sentence repeats in another military report. Eventually, in 1979, Warsaw Pact forces opposite NATO report was produced, and those three bases are identified there, and they are those three triangles here at the map, and even the number of warheads that is stored there, was stored there, is properly described. So in the end, I would like to refer to the main topic of this session. Until now, I said quite a lot about how the base was organized and how I use remote sensing techniques to recreate this base, to reconstruct it. But there is one element that is lacking from this equation, and those are soldiers who served there and lived there. They left many material traces around the base, like countless patrol paths they walked through patrolling the site. And one time when I was at Podborsk, I found this rubbish there. And as it can be expected, we can find some pieces of uniform, but between them, there's a charge room and there's a piece of toys. And this, it repeats again and again, many such pieces. And I did not know how to explain that. And then I met a person who helped me to do that, Mieczysław Ruch. He's ex-military retired Polish commander of the tank. When he got retired, he came back to his family village. He started to be interested in local history, and especially history at Podborsko, of Podborsko base, and he knows Russian, so he registered the two social Russian social media that are controlled by Russian government, Odnoklassniki and Kontakte, start searching for soldiers who lived at those bases, and soon he found them, and they started to send him some photographs from that base. Of course, they never speak about the restricted zone, they never refer to nuclear warheads or anything else, just ask. And between those photographs, it was that one. So it looks like those little fellas had brilliant childhood living in the middle of the forest with their families, and behind them were houses of NCOs that they presented you at the aerial photographs. And that photo completely changed the way I perceive the nuclear base, because usually according to the popular culture, we imagine those places as inhabited by almost cyborg-like soldiers who just dream to go about going to war and finishing the world in a spectacular nuclear fire. But this is not the case here, because what I saw surprised me. I saw people who loved to celebrate and dance. I saw whole happy families. Certainly, the dream of those people was not to go to war. They wanted to live in peace. It was just their work. I saw young soldiers who had their compulsory training there. And that really reveals the true nature of the conflict. Because we can imagine that if they were born in different political and historical circumstances, we could grow up together, play football, drink beer, watch some good movie, but that's not what happened. So I believe this is also, this should be also one of the main purposes of conflict archaeology, to reveal the nature of conflict. Thank you very much for your attention.